Good morning, Rochelle. Good morning and welcome. And good morning and welcome to those watching online. We would like for all to stand as we sing our call to worship. Let me sing the praises of Yahweh's goodness and of his marvelous deeds in return for all that he has done for us and for the great kindness he has shown to us in his mercy and in his boundless goodness. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you and we love you. We come here to worship you and to give honor and praise to your name. We thank you for getting us through this week, dear Lord, and we are just here to say thank you. Continue to watch over each and every one of us here that are going through trials, dear Lord. Lift us up. Help us to connect with you today. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us all open up our hymns to 3, 4, 1. To God be the glory.
Visitors online, thank you for joining us for worship.
We want to do a special shout out to Sister Sandy, who's in the back. Welcome.
Thanks
for joining us today. and to the Benabies from all the way from Nassau, Bahamas.
Amen. Welcome. Happy Sabbath. Welcome to New Rochelle.
So if anybody's going to the Bahamas, please see the Benabies after church.
Amen.
They will give you connections. Amen.
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 We want to start with our birthdays, and we've had a couple this week. We had our own Sister Tanisha Hamilton.
Amen.
Looking good. Happy birthday, love.
Happy birthday.
We had Mr. Jalen Gordon.
Happy birthday.
We had Nicholas Bell. He's away, but we're sending our love.
Yes, yes.
And today we have Sister Pat Green.
Yes.
Happy birthday to all of you. Amen. And if you've had any anniversaries this week, happy anniversary to you.
Amen, amen. Happy birthday.
On a Saturday note,
yes,
we want to extend our condolences to the Lutchman-Sink family. They lost their dad this week, so we want to pray for the family, send them some love, some condolences, and they will need all of our prayers. Amen. And announcements.
They also said, I believe the Mundles also experienced a loss as well.
I'm so sorry.
So we also want to extend our sympathy to them as well.
Exactly. And when we get more news, we will share that with you. Okay, announcements. Choir rehearsal resumes this afternoon. All right.
Next Sabbath.
Next Sabbath?
Yes, next Sabbath.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. Choir rehearsal starts next Sabbath. Sorry, guys, you have a week.
Sister Beale, they're talking to you. Next Sabbath, choir rehearsal resumes.
Okay. we have this afternoon for our singles. All of our singles, let's congregate at Mount Vernon SDA Church for our conference-wide game night. So come on, bring your thinking caps. Be at Mount Vernon today at 7 to 12 is the game night social.
Nice.
All right, this afternoon, we have AYS, our young people, Mr. John Emanuel is hosting, so I need all of you to come support our young people this afternoon at 4:30 in the library. We have our AYS. And on the 27th of this month, we have a couple of things. We have the mental health seminar for AY, and then for our couples, we didn't forget about you. We have a couples social in that afternoon. So April 27th, we have a mental health seminar at 4:30. And then for the afternoon, we have our couples. We have a social that's all for you.
Yes. I believe in lieu of hidden treasures today, we're going to continue with our friendship evangelism training.
Amen.
That will be at 3:30, so please join us for continuation of our friendship evangelism training. How many of you have been blessed thus far? Amen, amen.
The daily prayers.
Yes, and the daily prayers. So we have Sister Angela Powell, who has been blessing us. Welcome back, Sister Powell. It's good to see you. So she's been blessing us, and we are going to continue this afternoon with our training.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Hugh Carrington, he will be bringing us the word today.
Amen. Yes, we do.
And you can all stay behind. We have lunch upstairs for all of you. Amen.
Amen. We just want to remind you of our Bible studies that we have on Thursday night. So for our beginners, we have Bible studies at 7:30, and that is with Brother Mel Otterberry. Please take advantage of it. It is free. So please join us at 7:30 on Thursdays with Brother Mel Otterberry. And then on Friday, we continue as well for those who are a little bit more advanced at 8 p.m. for further Bible studies. So Thursday and Friday are the hot nights. Please join us 7:30 and 8 p.m.
And we are a praying church.
Yes.
And we want to continue to pray for a change of heart. Pray that God will help us to love our enemies, to do good to our haters, and to bless them that curse us, and to pray for our abusers. Allow God to work on us so that we can be a blessing to others. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
We just want to remind you that the pantry will be open after service, so please take advantage. If not for you, for someone that you may know that needs it, please come through. The pantry will be open after service.
Amen.
Yes, and just how many of you guys experienced the eclipse this weekend? Yeah? Pretty cool? Okay, how many of you guys experienced the earthquake last week? Pretty cool? Yeah? No? Not at all? I enjoyed. Okay. So as we know, we're seeing things rapidly happening in Earth's history, correct?
Yes.
if it's now more of a time for us to get ourselves right,
this is the time.
So please, let's be mindful of that. Of course, I have something for you guys before we leave. There was a prayer service that was happening, and Brother Carrington, or Dr. Carrington, would know about that. There was a prayer service going on. And so in order to start the prayer service, they asked an elderly gentleman to open up with prayer. And so the elderly gentleman starts praying, but in a very low tone. And so one of the other brothers are saying, "But Brother Walt, we can't hear you." And he says, "I'm not talking to you." All righty then. You'll get that tomorrow. Okay, good job. Yes.
Director, and we wish all of you
yes.
a blessed happy Sabbath.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Morning, church. How is everyone today?
Fine.
Wonderful. It's good to see you out there, see those wonderful smiles. Today, I'm going to talk about a topic that makes many individuals a little nervous, which is mental health. We all possess it. What really makes us nervous, and most people have negative thoughts about mental health, it's because it has a stigma attached to it. And it's really due to a lack of understanding of mental illnesses. And it's done that way because it's through ignorance. Just a lot of people just does not understand. And that because there's a lot of misinformation out there about mental health and mental illnesses. You know, it includes how we handle life, and that's what it's all about. So you can say, it can also happen because some people have negative attitudes. It can happen because of beliefs that we have. It can cause people to be a little prejudiced toward other people who have mental illnesses. This can lead to also discrimination. So what is mental health? Did anybody know? Anybody have an idea? Just one word. What is mental health? Well, it's simple. It includes our emotional well-being, our psychological well-being, and our social well-being. That wasn't scary, was it? That includes all of us. Let's put a smile on your face out there today. Mental health is a good thing. Because if we didn't have some positive mental health, we would all be probably in a hospital somewhere. So let's be glad that those of us who are here, we're having good mental health. And that's a wonderful thing. This mental health includes how we handle life stresses in every stage of life, from childhood to adulthood. There are many causes of mental illnesses. Although it's not known exactly what causes mental illnesses, but a combination of biological and other factors can contribute to a mental illness, including a lack of sleep, which I am guilty of. Thank God I've got my right mind this morning, because I don't always sleep. And with a lack of sleep, that can cause some mental illnesses in you. Brain injury can cause a mental illness, and many more factors that we won't go into today. To find out more about our mental illnesses, how we need to check out ourselves sometimes, and begin checking your church app on tips and things about mental illness. On April the 27th at 4:30, we're gonna have NAMI to come here. NAMI stands for National Alliance of Mental Illness. This organization is the largest grassroots dedicated to building better lives for people affected by mental illnesses. They even have classes that can help you to learn to deal with your family members and friends who have a mental illness. But we want you to tell your family, your friends, your neighbors, if you know someone who has a family member, or even yourself, if you're struggling with a mental illness, which is nothing to be ashamed of, please come out to this program on what day? April 27th. It will be during the AY time at 4:30. And then after AY at 6:30, we are going to have our couples social. So we want you to keep these dates in mind and to remember, mental illness is not a bad word. Mental illness is what we often have, and we see it every day. Sometimes it's in mild cases, sometimes it's in more severe cases. But to learn more about it and how to support and help someone with a mental illness or to get support for yourself, it is really important that you come out to this meeting on April 27th at 4:30. What day? And as you know, our theme for this church for family ministries is healthy emotional families and healthy emotional church. Because if the family is healthy emotional, we will bring that into our church. So let us keep remembering that, not just when I'm speaking on it, but you should be repeating that to yourself all of the time. Have a wonderful Sabbath, and I can't wait for the rest of the church service today. Amen. Have a wonderful Sabbath.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Okay, I'll try one more time. Good morning, happy Abba Day. Yes, good morning. So I am Angela K. Powell, and I'm home. I'm not your guest, right? I am home. It's been 35 years since I've been home to New Rochelle Church. Hey, we got a director, pastor, amen. All right, I've been obedient over there, and I'm obedient over here, amen. You got to be ready to shift. So, okay. Who has the mic on with me? Anyone? Amen. All right, so we are here on behalf of Bible Discovery Center, and we are here to empower the saints and get you going. And we're here because of this commission, Matthew 28. Open your Bibles. You have new Bibles. You might need to mark them again. And it talks about go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, and teaching them whatsoever I have taught you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Well, God has taught me friendship, evangelism, living. I didn't say lism. Living is a lifestyle. But we had an opportunity. We've been here for a couple of days, and we started on Wednesday night talking about the best gift, which is the Holy Spirit. That's right. I got the Spirit. Amen. Right? It hasn't left. Praise the Lord. And also, then it said that we must go. He gives us that energy to go be a witness. So we did just that. We put it to practice. We went out and did practical application into the community and also door to door. So my brother here, Brother Deacon Bell, and my sister here, Sister Josie, they just two of 10 people that have gone out this week and ministered. But we had some people in-house also, and I want to just give kudos to two of the Donnas for what they had did. They made sure we were fed. So they had a ministry that they met as well.
You know, what we did this week is a culmination of your participation. For 21 days, we prayed. For the first 7 days, if you recall, we prayed for ourselves, for 7 days for ourselves. For the next 7 days, we prayed for the church family, the church body. We each prayed for each other. And the third 7 days, we prayed for the community. And on Wednesday, we went out. We met here Wednesday evening. On Thursday, as you know, we went out in the community. Now, I want to say this, and I want you to imagine this. We were only in the community for 5 hours in 2 days. 5 hours. 2 days on Thursday, 3 hours. 2 hours on Thursday, 3 hours on Friday. Here's the report. We met over 29 people who requested prayer and received prayer and wanted Bible study in 5 hours. In 5 hours. We hung over 40 door hangers. I wish I had one today to show you what it looked like. It's just a simple door hanger to say that we have Bible study on Thursday evenings at 7 with Brother Outerberry. But we hung over 40 door hangers, 5 hours. What did you do with your 5 hours this week? This is all we did in 5 hours. It's even more impactful than that. You see three of us here. See the other members that were out there. The other members that went out with us, please stand. Sister Hazel, I know, is outside. My sister right here, please stand. Besides Sister Beale, yes, please stand up. You were with us on Thursday, Friday. Sister, right there it is. Sister Reed was with us. Cherry, stand up, Cherry. Look around. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Sister Hazel's outside. Donna, come on up. Stand up, Donna. Donna was here with us. Donna was in the boiler room with us. Donna, my wife, Donna, stand up, Donna. You were talking about the boiler room. Those are those that were in the background making sure that we were able to go out and do what we did. I'm sure that there were those of you who were praying at home. Those of you who are praying on the job. Those of you who are praying in your cars. I am sure of it, unless we could not have a report like this in 5 hours. Now, you know the story in Acts. Thank you. The story in Acts chapter 3. There's Peter and John walking, and they go to the temple, and this guy begging him for some money, right? What does Peter say to him? Y'all remember? Say it out loud. But give I unto thee. I had no silver and gold. We had no silver and gold. But what we had is what we gave. We were able to lift up the Lord in prayer to many people who requested it and accepted it and received it. And we didn't even go far. I'd like to tell you this. We have hit less than 1% of New Rochelle. Less than 1% of New Rochelle in 5 hours. I've got 29 requests and hit over 40 doors. Now, if we had a little bit more help, amen. The rest is history, right? If we had a little bit more help, what we could do, imagine when we touch 5% of New Rochelle, what could happen? Brothers and sisters, the journey has just begun. Thank you for your prayers for 21 days. Thank you for your prayers during the rest of this week. I invite you to begin this journey with us. Friendship missionary. Friendship missionary, and that's what it's all about.
Well, praise the Lord. That's why we're here. And you may not could come and go out with us tomorrow, right? But we would love for everyone to come. We're going to have breakfast. We're going to have a training on how to give a Bible study. And then we're going to go out into the community one more time. And you heard a story about three categories of people, right? Well, two. All right. One, the young lady said this was a divine appointment. We all have a divine appointment, right? Then we had a person that knew the Lord. But guess what? I met a person that's been to this congregation all the way from Belleville, St. Louis area. And I meet a person that said, I've been to that church. even the postman, right? Woman, I'm sorry. And I sung that song, "Wait a minute, Mr. Postman," woman. And it just made her smile. And she took the flyer. And she said, "I know where that church is, and I'm going to come." That's all it takes. Friendship evangelism. Come and let us learn together, but more so, let us go together. May God bless you. You may go in your home. If you say, "Well, I'm not going to go out with you all," go in your neighborhood. Your neighbor need the good news of Christ our righteousness. Thank you.
Hey guys, I'm glad you're here. I'm at camp with my church, but I'm lost. We were all together hiking, but I stopped to tie my shoe. When I finished, I stood up and everyone was gone. I've been walking in the direction I think they went, but I've been walking all day. I think I'm walking in circles. Can you help me? What should I do? Pray? You think so? Okay, I'll pray. Dear God, I really need your help. I'm lost, and I really want to go home. Please save me. I believe you can do anything that's within your will, and I know you love me. So please, Lord, help me to find my friends. I trust in you always. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. It's David!
I told him to stay with the group. I told him pathfinders must learn to listen. But no, Micah wants to walk off and get lost. His mother is going to kill me.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thanks for being with Micah, boys and girls, and thank you for telling him to pray. Powerful things happen when you pray. Even more, when you believe in the power of prayer, and you're never too young to pray. Micah was lost until he believed in God and turned to God. Are there any big boys and girls out there who are lost because they don't want to believe? You know, the reason why I found Micah wasn't just because he prayed. I found Micah because he stopped walking in circles. Too many of us are running from our salvation when God asks us to stand still. Keep praying, boys and girls. And don't wait for trouble to pray. Pray at any time. God loves to hear your prayer. And for anyone that is still lost, stop running. 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 16 to 18 says, "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you."
Thanks everyone. I couldn't have done it without you. The church bus is ready to leave. I'll see you on another episode of Northeastern Kids.
Micah, let's go.
What profit is it if we kept his ordinances and that we have walked as mourners before the Lord of hosts? So now we call the proud blessed, for those who do wickedness are raised up. They even tempt God and go free. Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. When he blesses us, not even the on the vine will destroy your fruit of the vine. When he blesses us, we are blessed. He has promised that he will open the windows of heaven and pour us out a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. And my brothers and sisters, we are experiencing God's blessings every day. So let us continue to be faithful to God by returning an honest tithe and a faithful offering. We are so grateful to you for your love, your mercy, and your grace. You have fulfilled your promises to us by providing for our every need. You have kept us in good enough health that we could walk into your church today to worship you. Come ye blessed of my Father. We do want to inherit that place, that mansion that God is preparing for us even now. So again we say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, New Rochelle. We're grateful that today's the Sabbath day. And we're so grateful that today we're in God's house. There is no other place on earth you want to be on Saturday, on God's day. I'm going to read a text from Isaiah 43:2. It's an amazing promise, which I believe applies to each one of us. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. The only hope, the greatest hope and stone we can be anchored to is our Lord Jesus Christ. And the most beautiful things that I love in the Bible are His promises that He will never forsake us. He will never leave us alone. Though we pass through the fire, through waters, and it's amazing that God is always near to us in the happy moments, in the sad moments. He's right next to us, always. And He wants to carry us into eternity. And we thank God for that.
Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer.
Have we trials?
Have we trials and temptations?
My God, is there trouble anywhere?
Is there trouble anywhere?
Our precious Savior,
He is still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Some things we have not. Because we ask not. When we have a friend who cares, we should never be discouraged.
Approach the throne of God in prayer and in submission. Heavenly Father, through your Son Jesus Christ, through his sacrifice, guided by your Holy Spirit, we approach you today, dear Lord, and we bow before you at your throne of grace. And you thank you for your calling, for the fact that you knock on our heart's door daily to come to you, dear Lord, have a tight relationship with you. We thank you for this calling, and we thank you for your Holy Spirit, which we ask you, dear Lord, to pour it upon us, upon your church in abundance. We thank you for our sister Powell that came in our church after 35 years bringing good news. We thank you for the friendship evangelism, for everybody that participates, dear Lord. And we thank you for the seeds that have been planted in people's hearts. Bless them with your Holy Spirit and their family, dear Lord. And we thank you. Bless our church, dear Lord, and especially the Lachman Singh family, the Walker family, Ross family. Bless them, dear Lord, in these hard moments that they pass through, dear Lord. It's not easy to lose a loved one. But we thank you, Lord, for your promise that one day we'll be all reunited at the Sea of Glass. And we bless you, dear Lord, for that. And we thank you for that hope. And for the strength that you're blessing us to get there. Please, dear Lord, have mercy on these families. Bless their hearts with your healing power, dear Lord. Surround them and bless them. Cover them with your Holy Spirit. And try to complete, dear Lord, the missing in their life. Bless them, and we thank you, dear Lord. And we await your answer. Blessed be your holy name. Bless each member of our church. especially, dear Lord, be close today to those who are sick and they need healing, dear Lord. Stay near to them. Reveal yourself to them, dear Lord, and make your presence be known through your healing and peace and love and faith that you can restore into them, dear Lord. And we thank you. Bless our church school, dear Lord. All the students that are in this school, their parents and their families. Bless all the students that are related to our church, dear Lord. Professors, teachers. Bless them with your Holy Spirit and help them pass their exams. Find happiness and joy in studying and spending time in becoming better people for you and for your kingdom, dear Lord. Now we come before thee with our hearts, dear Lord. We have things in our hearts that we cannot tell anybody. But we come today before you, dear Lord. And we ask you to answer our unsaid prayers, dear Lord. Have mercy on us, dear Lord. Forgive us. Cover us with your forgiveness and love. Give us strength. Bless us with the presence of your Holy Spirit. Not to shadow your face anymore, dear Lord. And we thank you. And we ask you through your Holy Spirit, dear Lord, to bless the speaker of the day. Dress him, cover him with your Holy Spirit, dear Lord. Dress him in your righteousness. And speak through him, dear Lord. And open our minds and hearts that we may receive the bread of life. Complete our prayers, dear Lord, with your holy will and grace and love. And we thank you, dear Lord. Blessed be your holy name today. And we want to be also into eternity with you, with our loved ones, to praise you, dear Lord, to be amazed of your wonderful works and of your salvation towards each one of us. In Jesus' name I pray, through your Holy Spirit, in the presence of your angels. Amen.
Some things we have not, because we ask not. Should never be discouraged when we take it to the Lord in prayer.
Amen. 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 Cynthia, please say something in your mic so we get a level.
Good afternoon, Rochelle.
Can I get more in her mic,
good
please?
Good afternoon.
So keep talking.
We are very happy to be back together this week to give you praise and to give God praise and glory. And we ask that you worship with us today.
Amen. Amen. Okay, now listen. I'm so happy to see you today. How many people are happy to be in the house of the Lord one more time? Amen. You done fought and clawed and clawed and clawed. You done dealt with the man, dealt with the job. You done dealt with personal loss. You done dealt with your children acting up, your husband or your wife looking at you kind of funny. But we are in the presence of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
And we are on one accord. So I'm just going to take a little poll right now. How many people like anthems?
Amen.
Anthems. Okay, now watch this. I'm going to get you out of your comfort level, out of your comfort seat. If you like anthems, please stand up. Good. Amen. Now, there are going to be like three or four categories. Okay, no. So remain standing okay, listen. How many people like hymns? Stand up. Good. How many people like traditional gospel? Stand up. Just remain standing. Okay, cool. How many people like contemporary gospel? Stand up. Contemporary Christian. Amen. Spirituals. Amen. Cool. Instrumental music. Praise music. Amen. See, here's the thing. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Amen. So we're going to be doing it all. Your anthems, your spirituals, your hymns, your instrumental music. And it's long, just like Paul said, as long as Christ is preached, amen, it doesn't matter what kind of package it comes in. But certain things speak to us.
Yes.
Like, I love classical music. I love hymns. I love gospel. I love contemporary Christian. Matter of fact, I think I like it all. Especially when it's talking about my Savior. Amen?
Amen.
So just worship with us. And if your song is done today, we don't mind if you stand with us. Amen?
Amen.
We don't mind if you clap your hands, raise your hands, whatever. Amen?
Amen.
Because we're going to do what we've been commanded to do, and that's to praise God. Amen?
Amen.
If you're breathing, anybody breathing out there today?
Yes.
So if you got breath in your lungs, breath in your body, we're going to praise the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Here we go. One, two, three.
Truth of the Lord endureth forever.
the Lord. We were made to praise the Lord. We will praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah, Rochelle. With my whole heart, I will praise Him. With my spirit, I will praise Him. With my soul, I will sing. Praise the Lord.
With my whole heart, I will bless Him. With my spirit, I will thank Him. With my soul, I will say, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Soul, I will say, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will bless Him. With my spirit, I will thank Him. With my soul, I will say, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will bless Him. With my spirit, I will thank Him. With my soul, I will say, praise the Lord, 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 praise the Lord.
Amen. Amen. I often say, can you guys hear me out there? I often say, if God can watch out for the little bitty bird, the sparrow, and he took his time to stoop in the mud and fashion us with his own hands, amen? So if he can look after the little bird, what do you think he's going to do for us? He comforts us. He guides us. He provides for us. He loves us with an everlasting love. Amen?
Amen?
And that's good news today. Here we go.
Oh,
Sometimes it's a struggle to even get out of bed some mornings because I'm being attacked by the devil. Anytime you call for a great purpose to God, amen, you are a target for the devil, for the enemy. And then I just remind myself, greater is he who's in me than he who's in the world, amen. The joy of the Lord is my strength. I don't have to carry it alone. This next song just says, the Lord is my shepherd. He goes before me, defender behind me. He got your back. And then because of that, we won't fear. Amen?
Amen.
Come closer. Lord?
The Lord is my shepherd. He goes before me, defender behind me.
I like this part. It says, He always guides me.
He always guides me.
When you're lost, sometimes you need a guide.
Through mountains and valleys. His joy is refreshing. Restores my soul. Mercy and goodness. Gives me assurance.
Then I'll take you up. He's my comfort.
He's my comfort. Always holds me close.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
victory, victory.
Lord, we
some God we serve. I don't know about you, but we just need sometimes just to say hallelujah.
Yeah.
What an awesome girl God we serve. Thank you. Thank you guys so much for setting the tone for worship this afternoon. So let me say good afternoon and happy Sabbath. Come on. Good afternoon and happy Sabbath.
Good afternoon. Happy Sabbath.
Because you guys know whenever I come here, I've been here a few times now, I always enjoy the worship experience and I always enjoy being here. And so it is a pleasure for me to worship with you today and to have this opportunity just to share and to spend a few minutes with you. And so I bring you greetings on behalf of the administration, our departmental leaders, and the staff of the Great Northeastern Conference. And so the theme, you've probably heard me say it before, the theme for prayer ministries is a foundation of prayer. And so we believe that everything that you plan, come on, everything that you do, everything that you say, if you do it on a foundation of prayer, guess what? You're going to be successful. Not just the church, but individually, you're going to be successful. And so I want to thank everyone that has participated in our worship experience and has now gotten us to this point. Every song, every hymn, the prayer, everything, the scriptures, the tithes and offering, everything has led us now to this point to be able to hear a word from God.
Amen.
And so, Doc, I want to thank you. He's running around here somewhere. I want to thank you for the opportunity to come and for trusting me behind the desk this afternoon. And so I'm not going to be long. I thought someone would say amen.
Take your time, preacher.
I'm not going to be long. Give me about 30 minutes. Give God your full attention and watch Him transform your life. So let's go to work. Go with me to the book of 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel, chapter 12, And we're going to look at one verse that's going to set the tone for what we're going to talk about this afternoon. But you got to keep your Bibles open. 2 Samuel chapter 12 and verse 16. Our topic this afternoon is grace denied. 2 Samuel chapter 12 and verse 16. And it reads, David prayed to God that the child would get well. He refused to eat anything, and every night he went into his room and he spent the night lying on the floor. Grace denied. Would you pray for and with me? Father, free me that I may capture some wandering soul. Bless me that I may bless another. And when all is said and done, Lord, I pray that an impression so severe would be left upon our minds that we will forever be changed. May we come to understand the significance of understanding that sometimes grace will be denied. And the church said, amen. And so as I travel across the territory of the Northeastern Conference, I now have the awesome privilege of teaching and preaching about prayer and encouraging individuals and churches to come aside and spend some time in prayer. But here is a question for you this afternoon, New Rochelle. What do you do when God does not answer your prayer? What do you do when he does not answer how you were hoping he would? What are you going to teach now, Hugh? What are you going to preach about now, Hugh? Hugh, what are you going to say to that individual, to that church, when God does not answer his or her prayer? Well, allow me to use the narrative of David and his affair with Bathsheba to show you what you must do when grace is denied, when God does not answer your prayer. And so as Christians, we often talk about and we sing about the grace of God. How does the hymn go? Grace, grace, God's grace. Grace that will pardon and what? Cleanse within. We often talk about and we often sing about God's grace. We talk about God's grace being sufficient for us. 2 Corinthians 12 and verse 9. And he said unto them, my grace is sufficient for thee. And so if you've lived long enough and you've suffered at any point in your life, you know that grace is one of those distinctive features of Christianity that we all desire. Come on. But the question remains, what do you do when grace is denied? What do you do when God does not answer that prayer? And so many of us are familiar with the narrative of David's affair with Bathsheba and how he compounded that sin by now arranging for the murder of her husband, Uriah. So just allow me a few minutes to summarize this afternoon. And so David was supposed to be away at war, but he stayed behind. You see, oftentimes when we're not where we're supposed to be, we get ourselves in trouble. See, I could spend the rest of the afternoon there, but that's not why I came today. He's supposed to be away at war, but he stays behind. And so now he's idle and he's wandering around the palace. And he's going now from room to room. And he looks out the window and he saw a woman taking a bath on a rooftop. And now David is smitten by what he sees, and he wants to know. He's curious. He wants to know who she is. And so he sent his men to inquire. And so the report now comes back, man, that's Uriah's wife. And that should have been enough to deter David, but no. He sent his men back now, and the Bible tells us that he took her. And the Bible tells us that David slept with her. And many of you are spending time watching Hula or whatever it is, and Netflix or whatever it is. But the stuff that you're looking at on television is right in the Bible. So now, David slept with her, and now Bathsheba is pregnant. What do you do? And so David attempts now to cover up the affair, and he has a plan. If I can get, David is thinking in his head now, if I can get her husband back home, her husband now is going to sleep with her and she'll get pregnant. Well, she's already pregnant. He's thinking in his head. You see it now. And so Uriah would assume that the child is his. And so David sent for Uriah. And he returns home. But Uriah now unwittingly would not cooperate with David's plans. Uriah refuses now to go home to his wife while his men are away at war. And so left now with no other choice, David now ups the plan. David now begins to plot the murder of Uriah. David sends Uriah to the front line, the hottest spot of the battle, where he is killed. And so Uriah is assassinated. I have no other way to say it. I don't know how other to describe it. It was an assassination, a state-mandated assassination. And so the plan now is complete. And upon hearing that her husband was dead, Bathsheba now mourns for her husband. And when the mourning is over, the Bible tells us again that David sends for her, and this time he marries her. And she bore him, remember she's pregnant, so she bore him a son. And it's some nine months now later, but God is not happy. 2 Samuel 11, I tell you, keep your Bibles open. 2 Samuel chapter 11 and verse 27 confirms that God is not happy. It says now, but the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. And so now Nathan shows up and he confronts David. Nathan tells David that God, not me, Nathan tells David that not the church board, not the conference office. Nathan tells David that God is displeased with him. God is displeased with your actions, and guess what? He's going to punish you. And David responds now by repenting and asking for God's forgiveness. He did now everything that we were taught. But watch this now. 2 Samuel 12, here comes the punishment. 2 Samuel 12 and verse 15, it says to us, the Lord caused the child that Uriah's wife had borne to David to become very sick. Here comes the punishment. And so the child is sick. And verse 16 now, it tells us, our focus text, that David prayed to God that the child would get well. And he refused to eat anything. And the Bible tells us that every night he went in and he spent the night lying on the floor. So David prayed. He's fasting and he's prostrating himself before God. You see it? He's agonizing with God. He's praying. He's fasting. He refuses, the Bible says, to eat anything. And every night, instead of going to the bed with his wife, he's on the floor agonizing with God over this sick child.
And so his court officials comes to him in verse 17 and they said to him, man, get up. The chefs have prepared some oxtail and some peas and rice. Come on, somebody. He tells them that the chefs have made some curry chicken and some roti. Come on. We have now some sarel and we have some mabi. Come on. We have some ginger beer. Come on, David, get up and eat something with us. And the Bible tells us that David refused. He would not get up and he would not eat anything. Verse 18 now, it says a week later, the child died. After 1 week of praying and fasting and agonizing with God, the Bible tells us that the child dies. You see, the 7 is a perfect number. I can only imagine that David thought to himself, it's been 7 days and I've been agonizing and I've been praying and crying out to God. God surely will come through for me in 7 days. But the Bible tells us that 7 days later, a week later, the child died. God said no. And David experienced grace denied. God, I've messed up, but I'm repenting. Forgive me and show me some grace. But grace, the Bible tells us, was denied. The child died. And so I want you to put yourself in David's shoes this afternoon. You've sinned. Uh-huh. You've messed up. And you've repented. You did everything that you're supposed to do. You did everything that they taught you to do in primary Sabbath school class. If you sin, what do you do? Come to God, repent of your sin, and he's going to forgive you. But like David, the child is going to die. God forgives you, but guess what? The child is going to die. And so like David, you're experiencing what? Grace denied. And so you fasted and you've prayed all week for 7 days, but you didn't get the promotion after being on the job for 25 years. God blocked it. You didn't get accepted into the college that you thought you wanted to get into because God said no. The loan that you thought you were going to get to catch up now on the bills, you're behind 2 months. God blocked it. You thought you were getting married in 2023, but here it is April of 2024, and you're still not married because God said what? God said no. But you fasted, come on. And you prayed, you cried out to God for all week for 7 days, and you thought they were going to offer you the job after being unemployed for 3 years, but God blocked it. The loved one you've been praying for did not recover from that illness because God said no. And so you thought the relationship was going to mend, but God blocked it. And so now, New Rochelle, you're experiencing what? Grace denied. You see, sometimes we will fast, come on, and we will pray and God will not respond as we have prayed. So the question is, what do you do when God does not answer your prayer? What do you do now, Hugh? Well, you get up. Here's the answer. You get up, you worship God, you end the fast. You're saying what? Yeah, watch this now. You see, when grace has been denied, when God does not answer your prayer, you must do what? Get up. You gotta worship him. You got to end the fast. You're saying, what, Hugh, that can't be true. It's in the Bible. Let me show you. Go to verse 19 now. 2 Samuel chapter 12 and verse 19. And so when David now noticed that the his court officials were whispering to each other. He thought something was up. He didn't know. And so he said to them, "Is the child dead?" And they looked at him and they said to him, "Yes, the child is dead." In other words, grace has been denied. What did David do? Verse 20. The Bible says that David got up. I told you. The Bible told us that David got up from the floor. He took a bath. He combed his hair. He changed his clothes. You missed that. You see, for 7 days, you're going to wallow in your mess. For 7 days, you've been agonizing and you've been praying with God. But when grace is denied, you got to get up. Get up. Get up from the floor. Take a bath. One version of the Bible says he put on some lotion. Come on, somebody. Get up from the floor. Put on some lotion. Take a bath. Comb your hair. Change your clothes. And you're saying to me, "Hugh, why am I doing all of this?" Because you're getting ready to go to church. Look at it. The Bible says, then... It says, then he went and he worshiped in the house of the Lord. Somebody's with me this afternoon. When grace has been denied to you, you got to do what? You got to get up from the floor. Find yourself back in church. Now is not the time to go missing from church. Too many of us, when we're going through our stuff, and we agonize with God, and God doesn't come through for us, what do? We stay on the floor, and we wallow in that mess. But I'm saying to you this afternoon, do what? Get up from the floor. Take a bath. Put on some lotion. Comb your hair. Change your clothes, and find yourself back in church. But we're not done. Verse 20. It says, when he returned to the palace from worshiping, he asked for what? Some food, and he ate it as soon as it was served to him. David did what? He ate. He ended the fast. You see it now? Do you see it? You see it? So when grace is denied to you, what you got to do? Get up. Find yourself where? Back in church and end the fast. And I know you're saying, "Hugh, how can you be so cold? Hugh, how can you be so insensitive to me? Hugh, how can you be so confident? Hugh, how are you expecting me to move on so quickly?" Well, the reason I'm expecting you to move on, the reason I can be so confident, the reason is because God has spoken. You see, when grace has been denied, the reason you're able to get up, the reason you're able to worship God, the reason you're able to end the fast is because God has spoken. You see, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, this was the moment. This was the turning point for David when he realized now the gravity of his sins of the situation, and he acknowledged now that he deserved what? Punishment. Look at Psalms. Psalms 51, verse 1 through 4. David cries out, "Have mercy upon me, O God. According to the loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies," he says now, "blot out my transgressions." Verse 2, he says, "Wash me thoroughly from my iniquities and cleanse me from" what? "My sins." Here it is. Here it is in verse 3. He says, "For I acknowledge." There it is. He says, "For I acknowledge my transgression, and my sin," he said, "is ever before me." And in verse 4, he says, "Against thee," not the church board, come on. He said, "Against thee," not the conference office. He says against thee, not your family. He says against thee have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight. And so the getting up, the worshiping God, the coming back to church, the ending your fast is acknowledgement. Here it is, New Rochelle, that you deserve punishment. I know you don't want to hear that. And so now, his court officials are confused. Look at verse 21. They're confused. They said, we don't understand what is happening here. They said to him, while the child was alive, you wouldn't eat anything. While the child was alive, you prayed and you cried out to God. While the child was alive, you spent night after night on the floor. But now that the child is dead, as soon as the child died, you got up. As soon as the child died, you went to church. As soon as the child died, you ended the fast. They're confused. As soon as grace was denied, you went to church. You ended the fast. You see, when grace is denied and you do the opposite. You see, everyone else is expecting you now to curse God and die. But when grace is denied and you do the opposite of what everyone else is expecting you to do, it's going to confuse them. It confuses the enemy, but God has done what God has spoken. And so David answered them. Now I'm in verse 22. David answers them and he says, yes. Yeah, I did. I fasted while the child was alive. Here is why, he said. He said, I thought that the Lord might be merciful unto me. I thought the Lord might show me somewhat, some grace, and not let the child die. Verse 23. But he said, but now that he is dead, now that grace has been denied, David said to them, why should I fast? I told you, you got to end the fast. He said to them, could I bring the child back to life? Mm-mm. He said, I will someday go where he is, but he can never come back to me. In other words, God has spoken. God has spoken. Grace has been denied. And David is saying, I'm accepting what? That God knows best. But the question still remains, what do I do now, Hugh? Where do I go from here? Come on, Hugh, I still don't have the promotion at work. Hugh, I'm still not in college. Where do I go from here? Hugh, the bills are still not paid. Hugh, I'm still not married. Where do I go from here? Hugh, do you realize it's been 3 years and I'm still unemployed? Hugh, my family member, my husband, my wife, my children are still sick. Where do I go from here? Hugh, I'm still grieving the loss of my loved one. Hugh, my relationship is still in trouble. Where do I go from here? Hugh, I understand and I know that God has spoken, but where do I go? Where do I go from here? Well, I'm glad you want to know. It reminds me of the song by Whitney Phipps. He says, but if he chooses not to move, in the way we prayed he would, Phipps says to us, be confident. Mm-hmm. He's working it all together for my good. And I will stand behind his word, for he is what? He's able. And so the question is, what now? Where do I go from here? Here it is.
You move on knowing that God is not done. They didn't hear me. I said you gotta move on knowing that God is not done. I'm almost done. Give me a few more minutes. And so New Rochelle, you got to understand that we serve a God who never slumbers and he never sleeps. We serve a God who is always on the case. And he is fully aware of your situation. Whatever you're going through, God is aware of it. He's aware of your situation and how you're being impacted and affected by it. So here it is. If you don't hear anything else this afternoon, I want you to hear this. The faster you move on, knowing that God is not done, is the faster God is able to bless you. They didn't hear me over here. Let me come over here. The faster you move on, knowing that God is not done, is the faster he can bless you. No. Let me come over here because I don't think they understand what I'm trying to say to you. The faster you get up, you're with me now. The faster you come back to church, the faster you end the fast, is the faster God can bless you. Let me show you. Last two verses. 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 24 and 25. So David understood this, and David did what? He moved on. 2 Samuel chapter 12, 24 and 25. Here it is. So David, the Bible says now, I'm going to enjoy this all by myself. So David comforted, the Bible says, his wife. You missed it. It says David did what? Comforted his wife. Let me come down because you didn't get this. If you go back to verse 15 of 2 Samuel chapter 12, the Bible says the Lord caused the son that Uriah's wife had born to get sick. But now in verse 24, it is his wife. David moved on. And so now it is his wife. And he's no longer now on the floor. He's comforting his wife. He's in bed with his wife. And for the married folks, you understand now he's experiencing some pleasure. My God. They're not with me. You don't understand what I'm saying. And so he had, the Bible says, intercourse with his wife. And she bore him a son who David named Solomon. David moved on. And so the faster you move on, knowing that God is not done, is the faster he can bless you. And so it, whatever it is, will become yours. It was Uriah's wife, but now it is his wife. And David experience, the Bible says, some pleasure. When you move on, it becomes yours. When you move on, you're going to experience some what? Some pleasure. You don't get it. They're going to get it when they get home. And then in verse 25, it tells us that the Lord loved the boy and commanded the prophet Nathan to name the boy Jedidiah. Because he loved him. In Hebrew, Jedidiah means loved by God. Let me wrap this thing up. Let me show you. And so sometimes you're going to pray, and God will deny you grace. He will not answer that prayer. Yes.
But in time, God will send the same prophet, the one who brought you bad news. He will send the same prophet back with good news. Come on, somebody. And so know this afternoon that God is not done. The supervisor that God allowed to block your promotion is the same supervisor that's going to sign off on your promotion. God is not done. The college that rejected your application is the same college that's going to accept you on a full scholarship. God is not done. The organization that God allowed to reject your job application is the same organization that's going to offer you your dream job. God is not done. The same prophet that brought David bad news, you have sinned. God is not happy and he's going to punish you. The same prophet that brought David bad news was the same prophet that brought him good news. God was not done. And so while prayer is a powerful tool for connecting with God and expressing our needs and expressing our desires and expressing our wants, I gotta let you know, New Rochelle, it's important for you to understand that God's response to your prayer is not always what you expect or what you would want. You see, in some cases, your prayers may not align with God's will for your life. Consequently, sometimes God will choose to deny your request, even though you have prayed and you have fasted and you have agonized with Him over those with all of your heart. You see, if you are not in a place of obedience and surrender to God, you don't want to hear it. If you are not in a place of obedience and surrender to God, He may choose to deny your requests. You see, God's timing is not always the same as your own. God's ways are not your ways. God's math is different. He may often take away so that He can add. And so sometimes subtraction may occur so that God can bless you. And so yes. You experience grace denied. But because you got up, and because you worship me, and because you ended the fast, because you accepted what I said, God has spoken, let the church say amen. When we sing that, what we're actually saying is that we're in agreement with whatever God has said. And so yes, grace has been denied. But because you got up, and because you worship me, and because you ended the fast, because you accepted that God has spoken, God said, now I can bless you with your Solomon. Now I can bless you with a king. Now I can bless you with wisdom. Now, God says, I can bless you with riches. Now, God says, I can bless you with what He loves. I can bless you with your Jedediah. David named the boy Solomon, but God sent Nathan back to tell him to name the boy Jedediah, which means what? Love by God. Now God is saying to you, I can give you what I love. Now I can give you what is best for you. Now I can give you your Jedediah. You can begin to play something softly for me. And so when grace has been denied, I'm saying to you, New Rochelle, be patient. Be patient while God prepares to give you what He loves. Be patient while he prepares to give you what is best for you. And so I don't know about you, but I've gotten to the point in my life where I no longer pray for what I want. I pray for what God loves. And so I want you to understand this afternoon that God wants to give you your Jedediah. He wants to give you what he loves, not what you love. You see, when you go back and you look at this narrative of David and his affair, David loved that first boy. And some of us love our sins, oh boy. We love our sins. We want to hold on to them. But if you hold on to what you love, you will never get what God loves. I know you didn't want to hear that. I know that's not why you came to church, but it's the truth. Let go of what you love, and God is going to give you your Jedediah. He's going to give you what he loves. Too many of us continue to hold on to our sins. And we love them. David loved that boy. But God says, my math is different from your math. And I don't know, was one of my questions when I get to heaven. God, what would have happened if you had allowed that boy to live? We would have never have had a Solomon. And so each of you have to look at your individual life. You got to realize that there's some things that you're holding on to. And God is saying, if you let it go, I'm going to give you what I love. I'm going to give you Jedediah. I'm going to give you your Solomon. I know I'm messing with you. You didn't come to church to hear this, but that's why I came. So your heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Not going to ask you to raise your hands. Not going to ask you to stand up. Between you and God, what are you holding on to that God is saying, if you give this up, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to give you your Jedediah. What are you holding on to? What job? What relationship? Come on. What church position? Come on. Uh-huh. What are you holding on to? God is saying to you, I want to give you something else. Between you and God, let it go. Make the commitment right now that you're going to let it go. And ask him even right now, bless me with my Jedediah. Bless me, Lord, with what you love. Not with what I want. Pray, come on. Between you and God, make the commitment. You're going to let it go. And now I want you to join me collectively as we pray. Just a few more minutes. There may be someone here today
You've been wondering, why do I keep not getting what I want in life? And you now understand. And you're here today, the purpose you're here today, the reason you're here today is because God wants to give you something else. He wants to give you your Jedediah. And so if you're here today, you've never accepted Lord as your Savior, I'm offering you Him today. I'm offering you God. I'm offering you Jesus Christ. If you're praying, you're praying, you're praying, church. If you're here today, I want you to come. I'm going to come and I'm going to meet you. I want to pray with you. This church, the elders are going to surround you. They're going to study with you. There's two Bible studies Thursday and Friday. You can join one of them and they're going to work with you. Do you come to an understanding of this God that we serve? This God that wants to give you your Jedediah. Are you here today? Come on. Raise your hand. I'm going to come and meet you. Not going to be much longer. Five. Come on. Four. Three. Two. I'm going to keep praying. I'm going to keep praying for you. Let's end. Let's end. Your heads are bowed. And so, Father, this afternoon, all we can say is thank you. Thank you for the reminder that there are some things in our lives that we must give up. That there are some things in our life that are preventing you from giving us what you love. From giving us our Jedediah. And so like David, this afternoon, we're getting up. Like David, this afternoon, we return to the house of worship. Like David, this afternoon, we're ending the fast. And we're moving on, expecting that you will give us what you love. And so all we can say is thank you. Thank you for hearing and for answering our prayer. In the precious name of Jesus we pray. And the church said,
save me by thy grace. Let's take the verse again. Trusting only in thy merit, would I seek thy face. Heal my broken spirit, save me by thy grace. Oh, I'm calling save me from
Dr. Carrington. Amen. Let us all stand as we sing the closing hymn, number 590, Trust and Obey, number 590.
Do His good will.
My victory, your spirit lives within me. One more time. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I am not alone.
What's up? He's my comfort. Watch it, watch it. Go.
He's my comfort. Always holds me close.
Amen. Oh, y'all want a concert, I see. No. I'm just joking. Come on, y'all.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, all ye people, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, all ye nations, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, all ye people, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. All ye nations, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. All ye people, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. All ye nations, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. All ye people, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. His merciful kindness is great toward us, and the truth of the Lord endureth forever. We were made to praise the Lord. We were made to praise the Lord. We will praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Lord, all ye nations, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, all ye people, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, for his merciful kindness is great to us, and the truth of the Lord enduring forever. For his merciful kindness is great toward us, and the truth of the Lord endureth forever. For his merciful kindness is great toward us, and the truth of the Lord endureth forever. Praise the Lord, we will praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will bless him. With my spirit, I will thank him. With my soul, I will say, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will bless him. With my spirit, I will thank him. With my soul, I will say, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will bless him. With my spirit, I will thank him. With my soul,